Welcome to episode 15 of Handcast, a weekly recap of the results, news and rumors in the handball world. This podcast will give you all the important results of the past week, an outlook on the upcoming matches, as well as everything important there is to know about handball at the moment. Today we will start with the Super Globe before we talk about the Champions League. We then get to the Bundesliga and the other European leagues before I will talk about some transfer rumors and news. But now, without further ado, let's get started. The Super Globe is currently being played. West Brom, Barcelona and Magdeburg all play for it in three groups. West Brom beat Taubate from Brazil and Zamalek from Egypt. Barcelona beat Sydney and Ayali from Egypt. Magdeburg played California and Al-Khalei from Saudi Arabia, of course winning both matches too. On Tuesday there will be the semifinals between Barcelona and West Brom as well as Magdeburg and Al-Ahli. And on Thursday the final and third place match. The European teams are of course highly favored. Who do you think will take the title this season? Let me know in the comments below. The Champions League went into round 3 and the big conclusion of this match is that this season will be more competitive than ever before. We started on Wednesday with Kolstad against Zagreb. The Norwegians really needed their first points here to be competitive this season. Zagreb surprisingly beat Aalborg the week before. Kolstad took a 4-goal lead in the first half, but Zagreb came back. The game was tied at halftime. Zagreb was in good shape with 8 goals from Klarica. But Kolstad finally managed to improve, taking the lead in the second half. Sigvalde Gudjonsson scored 11 goals and therefore Kolstad finally takes their first 2 points, getting into the fight for a playoff spot. A true highlight was then played between Aalborg and Magdeburg. The Danes had to do good after losing the week before, but Magdeburg was willing to take the fight. Aalborg started very well, Nielsen and Wiesmach scored 7 goals each. Aalborg took a 4-goal lead by halftime. But Magdeburg countered with 7 goals by Christiansson. The game was head-to-head in crunch time. Last shot from Hoxha is saved and this game ends 33-33, a fair tie. I think this is the fair result here. The match of this round, however, was played between Sporting and West Brom. The Portuguese had not dropped a single point yet, but they were still the clear underdogs against the mighty team from West Brom. But in what has to be considered the upset of the season, Sporting absolutely dominated the Hungarians from the start. Sporting played like this was a training match against the second team, in-flight goals everywhere, insane shots and a good keeper behind. They led by 6 at halftime and this was only the start, they went up by 12 in the second half. 12 against West Brom. And it was a team performance as well, Francisco Costa and Nedim Remeli were top scorers with 7 each. This was just a reality check for West Brom. This not only means that Sporting is now still undefeated, West Brom also drops 2 points after beating both Berlin and PSG, making the race for the top 2 spots highly interesting again. Even though Group A seems to be much weaker, it certainly just got similarly competitive to Group B. Chelsea then played Barca and of course had a hard time, going down by 4 at halftime already. Barca kept up the pace with 8 goals from Richardson. Without Alex Dushipayev or Sitschko, Chiesa put up a decent fight but just could not challenge Barcelona. They lose 28-32, Barca collect the next 2 points in Poland. On Thursday, Szeged against Nantes promised to be one hell of a fight, both teams with good starts to the season and high hopes for this match. Szeged used the home advantage, going up by 2 at halftime, Marius Hastaric scored 7 for them. Nantes was close however with 9 from Rivera, another amazing performance from the experienced Spaniard. This match came down to the last attack and after Richard Bodo scored a screamer last week against Barcelona to get back within 1, this time he took a final shot from about 9 meters, burying it and winning this match for Szeged 33-32. An amazing finish to a very close match, Szeged takes 2 important points at home, Nantes deserves at least a point but they just got unlucky by the end. Federica was the clear underdog against Berlin, but they managed to tie it by halftime. They even took a lead, but Lasse Andersson scored an insane goal from 18 meters away to tie it right at the halftime buzzer. Berlin then got back in form in the second half, winning this match 32-38. Evgeny Pevnov scored 6 against his former club, Andersson on 8, Gidze and Tolbring on 7 proved to be too strong however. Bucuresti keeps on performing well. They also beat Pelistoff 34-25 after leading by 6 at halftime already. Miklos Rosta scored 7 goals, Kuzmanovski scored 9 for Pelister, but from 16 shots. Nikola Mitrevski at least kept them somewhat in this match with his 14 saves, but once again, Pelister cannot keep up with the competition. At last, Prots played PSG and this match could have gotten either way, with both teams struggling at the start of the season. The match was tied at halftime, Michał Daszek once again performed well with his 8 goals, Hallgrimsson with 13 saves on 39% played amazingly as well. Szybczak however scored 7 for PSG, Stein 6, so this match got down to the last few minutes. PSG was up by 1, but Prots gets a final penalty with time running out. And the hero of this match is Andreas Palicka. Not only did he save 13 shots on 48%, he also saves this last penalty, securing the 23-24 win for PSG. A tie would have been deserved, however Palicka gives PSG 2 points, a very unlucky result for Prots, however. The team of the round therefore starts with Palicka, 13 saves, 48% and a game-winning save. This just has been his match against Prots. Once again, Valero Rivera makes the left wing position, 9 goals from him, he just keeps on performing, putting up world-class numbers. Same as Lasse Andersson, 8 goals from him, put him in my team of this round. Gisli Kristiansson gets my best playmaker nomination with his 7 goals against Aalborg. Melvin Richardson led Barca to the next 2 points with his 8 goals. Sigvaldi Gudjonsson was top scorer of this round, giving Kolstad its first 2 points, scoring 11 against Zagreb. On the line, Miklos Rosta scored 7 for Bucuresti, making a list this week for me. That's it, my team of the round. Let me know who you would have selected in the comments below. The table now looks like this in Group A. Sporting and Bucuresti still unbeaten, the favorites Berlin, West Brom and PSG follow close behind. Prots after them and Pelistan Fredericia still without points. Group B is still led by an unbeaten Barcelona team, second now in second place, followed by Magdeburg and Aalborg. The rest now all on 2 points, Chiesa, Zagreb, Nantes and Kolstad all in a close fight for the playoff spots. Next week, Zagreb has a hard task with Szeged, PSG gets an easier opponent in Fredericia. Pelister won't stop an unbeaten Sporting team, I think. West Brom and Bucuresti will be very interesting. I think West Brom will and has to give the first loss to the Romanians. Berlin are the favorites against Prots, Magdeburg as well against Chiesa. Nantes are favorites against Kolstad, but it could get close. Barcelona against Aalborg will be the highlight of the round, but I think the Catalans are too consistent, especially at home. The Bundesliga played out match day 4 over the week, but started with a rescheduled match from match day 10. Stuttgart played Gummersbach and this was a masterclass by them, going up by 9 at halftime already. Mahir scored 8 goals, the class difference was clear to see. Gummersbach wins 28-35, Stuttgart continues its bad start to the season. The actual match day 4 then started with a real cracker, as Kiel would play Melsung. The Zebras lost this match last season, so they were up for revenge after beating Magdeburg, they were favored, but they still had their injury problems plaguing them. But just like last season, Melsung just seems to be working well at Kiel, leading 15-8 by halftime. Madsen and Christopans both scored 7, but the game changer was Nebojša Simic in goal, who managed 19 saves on 49% efficiency, causing headaches for Kiel. He is the reason they could not really get into this match, so Melsung repeats their victory from last year, beating Kiel 21-25, causing their second loss of the season already. A very clumsy start from Kiel again, even though it's understandable with the injury troubles they have. Melsung once again starts strong into the season. Next up was Leipzig vs. der Löwen, a very close match developed, it was all tied at halftime. Martinovic scored 9 goals, but this match was a battle of keepers. Both Spät and Severos saved 16 shots, being on 39%. This match could have gotten either way. In the end, Rukavica scores the winner in the 59th minute, giving Leipzig a 28-27 win. This match could have gone either way, but this means the Löwen dropped the first 2 points of this season in Leipzig. The next day, Göpping played Hannover and they fought well. It was tight at halftime, but in the second half, Hannover managed to set themselves apart. 10 goals from Uschins and 9 from Fischer against 9 from Sarac. Hannover takes the next win, 31-33, continuing their great form. Eisenach had a hard home match against Flensburg. They ran behind for huge parts of this game, being down by 4 at halftime and in the end losing 25-30. Pütlich scored 9 here and not even 14 saves from Spikic could stop them. Flensburg is now the only unbeaten team left in the league. Bietigheim played Gummersbach, going down by 4 at halftime, but they came back close in the second half. Julius Kühn was on fire with 9 goals, but Mahé again with 7 goals and 6 assists was just too strong. Rebmann kept Bietigheim in this match with 14 saves, but they still lose 30-32. Gummersbach really plays well despite of the injuries of Köster and Einarsson, slowly getting better and better each week. Berlin then played Erlangen and it was tied at halftime until Berlin took a solid lead in the second half, winning 30-27 with 8 goals from each Gitze and Andersson. Both Lasse Ludwig and Clement Verlin saved 14 shots, a decent win for Berlin, nothing more. At last, Stuttgart played Wetzlar. Both were without points this far. Wetzlar only led by 1 at halftime. Lenny Rubin switched teams ahead of the season and he was top scorer with 7 for Stuttgart. However, Wetzlar still overcomes them, winning 23-26, gaining the important first 2 points this season. Erlangen now really looks like the top contender for relegation. They achieved nothing this far and they don't seem to be competitive against most opponents. The table now looks like this, Flensburg still on top, now the only unbeaten team, followed by the Löwen, Melsung, Hannover, Berlin and Leipzig, all with a single loss. Gummersbach gets ahead of Magdeburg and Lemgo, who did not play because of the Super Globe. The second half of the table starts with Kiel and Bietigheim, followed by Hamburg. Eisenach leads the relegation fight together with Wetzlar, Stuttgart with their first points behind, Göpping on 1 point and the bottom with no points consists of Potsdam and Erlangen. Next week, Hannover will probably continue winning against Eisenach, Kiel has to get back on track against Stuttgart. Melsung gets an easy opponent in Bietigheim, let's see whether Julius Kühn can surprise against his former club. One team will get its first points in the match of the bottom teams between Erlangen and Potsdam. This could go either way, could even be a draw, the next important match in the relegation struggle. Wetzlar should be a win for Berlin, Lemgo against Leipzig could be really close though. Gummersbach seeks the big upset against Flensburg, however without Köster I doubt it, the Löwen could return to winning formula against Hamburg. At last, Magdeburg should take 2 points against Göpping. Göpping just gets all the hard matches in a row this season. We now take a look at France. There, PSG won their match, but Nantes had the home match against Montpellier, so a first meeting of 2 big favorites in the league. Nantes already lost to Toulouse the week before, so they had to do good on that and try not to fall back too early. Aymeric Mine led them with 7 goals, Montpellier had the better goalkeeper performance with 12 saves from Bosinger. Nantes still managed to take over the match after it being tied for about 45 minutes, going up by 3 and in crunch time even by 4, taking this important win 29-26. The home team takes the win, important for Nantes, and a first loss for Montpellier. In Poland, both Kielce and Płock won their matches, same goes for Szeged. West Ham is at the Super Globe and therefore did not play in the league. In Denmark, GOG won over Holstebro, Skjern lost to Bjerringbro Silkeborg and Fredericia won their match against Kolding. In some transfer rumors, West Ham seems to be willing to get back some Hungarian talent in Zoran Ilic, Gergely Fasikas and Christoph Palasic. The latter two are on loan currently and therefore it would just make sense. Ilic of course would be a decent backup for Remeli or even Dika Mem if he comes. Remeli would switch even more to the middle then. West Ham can afford it and of course it just makes sense to put some homegrown talent into a Hungarian team. It basically only depends on the coach and if he wants to work with these players. Overall, West Ham has so many stars, getting in some identity forging figures would not hurt in my opinion. On the other hand, the contracts of Casado, Fabregas, Sandell and Descartes are running out by the end of the season. Sandell would of course be replaced by Mem or Ilic. Casado seems to be the one to leave for Fasikas when he returns from loan. These two will leave most likely. This car also is not really needed because they have Elison as well. Maybe they get in other Hungarians there. The big question remains what happens to Fabregas. We heard many rumors that he will return to Barca, however how will they even afford his salary with their financial troubles? Kiel also needs new pivots sooner or later, maybe he will be the next star joining them. However, in my opinion, West Brom should put every effort in trying to keep this star, because he might be the most important player in the world right now, world class both in attack and defense. With fellow Frenchman Remeli and his former coach Pasquale, and also former teammate Zindrich at the club, he should feel good there as well, and if Dika Mem joins as well, the golden Barcelona generation basically reunites at West Brom. I don't see him leaving West Brom, only if he himself really wants to, but objectively, there should be absolutely no reason for him. In some real transfer news, Erlang now finally got the transfer of Marco Bezsiak sealed. He joins them in the relegation fight, however I don't think he can help them much. He's an accomplished player, but just too old to do much in the Bundesliga in my opinion. In other news, Sander Sargosen got injured in the match against Zagreb. We now know it's a shoulder injury and he might be out for months, a huge problem for Kolstad of course, losing their biggest star. Let's hope he recovers soon, if not, Kolstad's chances of making playoffs get extremely slim suddenly. So that's it for this handcast, thank you so much for watching and listening and please let me know what you think in the comments below. Thank you for everything and for now, I will see you in the next video.